This video is sponsored by Sparkling Water from H-E-B. Here, everything's better. Just kidding, they're not our sponsor. If they want to be, we'll take it. Hey everybody, this is Rudy Carlos, co-host of Catholic Drive Time. Welcome back to this week's Memory Hole news segment, where we recall from memory five news stories that will certainly, absolutely get memory holed. These are stories off the beaten path, the ones that you might forget despite them having implications on your life. This week I have an array of articles for you, so let's jump right into the memory hole. Our first stories are from the Epoch Times, and here's the first one. The headline goes, San Francisco's new DA goes on firing spree after voters recall predecessor. The new district attorney in San Francisco fired at least 15 employees from the prosecutor's office after her left-wing predecessor, Chesa Boudin, was recalled last month. She says, quote, today I made difficult but important changes to my management team and staff as well that will help advance my vision to restore a sense of safety in San Francisco by holding serious and repeat offenders accountable and implementing smart criminal justice reforms, unquote. San Francisco DA Brooke Jenkins wrote in a statement about the firings. She continues, quote, I promised the public that I would restore accountability and consequences to the criminal justice system while advancing smart reforms responsibly, unquote. Boudin, her predecessor, was recalled on June 7th amid criticism of a citywide surge in crime, homelessness, and drug usage in public. Jenkins quit Boudin's office in 2021 after joining the DA's office in 2014. Now, I got into a bit of a spat with a random Instagram user the other day, as you do, and I thought this guy had his head in the sand about how liberal policies were destroying the country. He made a snarky comment about how the rise in theft in San Francisco had nothing to do with this video that he was commenting on about someone leaving their car windows and doors unlocked in San Francisco so that thieves wouldn't damage your car if they decided to try and steal something. Now, this is sadly a common occurrence in San Francisco and really all over the country, but particularly you see this in San Francisco. Here's a video that documents the type of crime that you see in San Francisco. Let's take a look. Pretty crazy video, right? Well, crime rates are soaring, and you see a lot of instances of smash and grab theft, as well as massive homelessness and drug addiction, as the article had mentioned. San Francisco really is kind of like a hellhole if you're living there, while nobody really does anything about it. Now, the previous DA, whose campaign was funded by George Soros himself, echoed other progressives who want to end incarceration and reimagine the criminal justice system. Once they get in, they create all kinds of different laws or tweak things so that a person who commits a crime is not actually held accountable. A lot of these ideas stem from the concept that the people who commit these crimes are somehow disadvantaged. They come from a disadvantaged system, so they have to be lenient with them. And then the looters who routinely rob stores are then emboldened to commit their crimes because there's hardly any repercussions for their actions, so they just do it. Now, just think for a minute of the implications of this, okay? One man in particular, George Soros, but it could be many different other people, has the capital, the financial capital, to put a particular flavor of politician in a powerful role in your city. They can fund their campaign, they can, you know, then run on all of the money that they need. It helps with advertising or getting the word out. How is that possible? You know, I wonder about that sometimes. How could it be that one person has this much power to do this? Well, there's all kinds of loopy ways that somebody can do it this way, and it happens because it's possible, and it is happening all across the country. So try and be informed about your local politics. You know, there's a tendency for us to think, oh, we got to think about the big picture. We got to think about who's in the office of the presidency right now. We have to think about that. That's the most important thing. Actually, what's most important is for you to be aware of your local politics. You know, in California, when I was still living there, there was a recall Newsom effort. People were trying to get signatures. And most people didn't know anything about this. Most people didn't even know why they want to recall Governor Newsom. But not enough people knew about it, and the recall simply failed. So you need to be informed. If you know that, for example, there's a politician in your city that's not doing very well, he or she is not representing the people well, get the word out. You know, try and get involved in that and try and get rid of them through a recall. Vote wisely. Here's the second article from the Epoch Times. This is a pretty crazy story, all right? So the headline goes, "Woman hospitalized with accidental overdose after picking up a $1 bill in Tennessee." Now just imagine it for a second. I apologize for that. I bumped my microphone there. Just imagine it for a second. You're on your way to a conference in Dallas, just kind of like this woman, Renee Parsons, was. And you stop at a Golden Arches, you know, you think, oh man, it's the only thing open, it's consistent, you know, I'll get some fries, I'll get a double cheeseburger or something like that. You pop in, and then you walk up to the counter, and you look to the left, and then you look to the right of the menu, and you place your order, and then all of a sudden you look down, and guess what's down there on the floor? To your surprise, you look down and you find yourself a dollar on the floor. Of course you pick it up. Despite the fact that the US dollar ain't what it used to be and it's not worth very much, you pick it up and bam, worst mistake of your life. Renee goes on to say, she says, quote, "I see a dollar bill on the ground, thinking absolutely nothing of it. I picked it up," she said. Within minutes, her body went numb and she could barely move or breathe. She says, quote, "It's almost like a burning sensation, if you will. It starts here at your shoulders, and then it moves down because it's almost like it's numbing your entire body." And then she says, she lost consciousness. Just think about that for a second. Just pause and just imagine you pick up a dollar on the ground. Such an innocent thing, innocuous, right? But it wasn't. Not for this woman. After that, she said she was taken to a nearby hospital. Staff treated her for an accidental drug overdose before she was released after 4 hours, according to the reports. The couple told local news outlets that her toxicology report did not test positive for synthetic drugs, but they said that they're confident that the $1 bill contained fentanyl or some other powerful drug. I happen to think it might have been fentanyl, because fentanyl is a nasty drug, and particularly in really small doses. It's enough to kill you. And it's being brought over the border. The smallest amount, as I mentioned, can kill you. There's stories that we've covered on Catholic Drive Time that are in the same vein. Wink, wink. Now, the CDC says that there was an estimated 107,622 drug overdose deaths in 2021. And that's a 15% increase over the previous record of 93,655, which was set in 2020. Drug overdose deaths rose 30% from 2019 to 2020. So that kind of has something to do with, people were locked inside of their house. They were completely distressed, isolated from everybody. And of course, the drug epidemic got worse because these people were just completely disconnected from reality, as we all were. And you can thank our dear leader for the crisis at the border and all of the crazy drugs that are being smuggled in, which are killing Americans. Okay, so moving on, we have another story here. This one is quite absurd. I invite you to be open-minded about this one. This one is from Breitbart. And the headline goes, "Paul Pelosi buys millions of semiconductor stocks before congressional subsidy vote." Now, this is right before the Senate is set to vote on a competition bill next week that would give a $52 billion subsidy to the semiconductor industry. This is according to Reuters. Paul Pelosi exercised 20,000 shares worth between $1 million and $5 million in NVIDIA, which is a semiconductor company based in Santa Clara, California. It was revealed that this happened in a disclosure that Nancy Pelosi filed to the House of Representatives on Thursday. Saying, quote, "Obviously, Speaker Pelosi would be aware of the timing of the legislation over at the Senate," Representative Ralph Norman said in an interview with the Daily Caller. He says, on the heels of that vote, for anyone in her orbit to purchase seven figures worth of stock of a U.S.-based chip manufacturer just reeks of impropriety. And really, it does. You know, Nancy Pelosi is among the highest earning members in the House regarding trading stocks and has stated that she opposes the ban of congressional members trading stocks. In July 2021, Paul Pelosi, her husband, netted a cool $4.8 million in options with Alphabet, which is the parent company of Google. Nancy Pelosi has denied that she owns any of the stocks that her husband trades. And I think this is just a way for her to sort of circumvent the situation here. She says, of course, it's not my money. It's my husband's money. It doesn't matter that they're married. It's not like she benefits at all from any of the money, right? I mean, it's not like Paul Pelosi's buying her freezer full of ice cream.
Thousands have been forced to wait for hours at food banks all across the country.
This is chocolate, and then we have some other chocolate here. We just got to restock the ice cream.
In any case, this is what's known as insider trading, or what we're speculating to be insider trading in this situation. A particular individual gets wind of information that isn't technically available to the public yet and buys or sells stocks to their financial advantage. There were some who even sold stock right before the market took a dive because of the COVID lockdowns. What a coincidence, huh? I mean, look, I'm not explicitly saying that he did this, but it sure is convenient, isn't it? You know, it's almost as if we're led to believe that a married couple who lives together in the same house, who share the same bed together, don't talk about anything about work. I mean, I talk about work all the time with my wife. It's completely normal. So it is convenient, isn't it? It's pretty convenient that he just happens to buy stock in this particular thing when it's about to get boosted. So anyway, it's too bad that we peasants don't have friends in high places to help us out like that. Here's another article. And I'm going to try not to seethe very hard. It's really a horrible, horrible thing that I'm about to read to you. So this one is from Life News. Good website, by the way. Good pro-life website if you want to get pro-life news. The headline goes, Michigan Governor Gretchen Whitmer will veto $21.4 million for pregnancy centers and adoption. Governor Whitmer will sign the state's budget into law, but use her line item veto to nix funding for pregnancy centers because she falsely claims that they lie to women just because they don't kill babies and abortions. Whitmer's communications director, Bobby Letty, cited connections to fake women's health centers or implementation concerns as the reason for the veto. This has since been vetoed. An update to the story is she actually did this. Now, funding expected to be vetoed within the general state budget includes $10 million to fund marketing programs that promote the adoption of infants and the development of factual educational information materials on adoption as an alternative to abortion, including the ability of the birth mother to establish a pre-birth plan. It also comprises $4 million for grants and other expenditures for safe housing, rather, and comprehensive supportive services without charge for pregnant women who are without a safe home and are in need statewide, which must include access to health and prenatal care, parenting and life skill development, and services and education for a stable transition to independent living. I never want to hear, never. After reading this story, I never want to hear that pro-lifers don't care about the baby after it's born. Never want to hear that ever again, all right? I mean, it's pretty obvious here. This is just one example, but this is a mask-off moment, okay? This is what every progressive abortion as a so-called right demander thinks, all right? This is what they want. They just want abortion. It's not about raising the kid. It's not about helping the children or adopting or anything like that. They claim that we don't care about the baby out of the womb. Well, what? How do you explain this from Gretchen Whitmer? How do you explain that? it's obvious. It's a mask off moment. All right, to round us off this week, the fifth story here is from Daily Wire, and it's going to start your weekend off with a bit of good news. The headline goes, stunning amount of money pours in for hero pizza man who saved five from a burning house. a 25-year-old stand-up pizza guy by the name of Nicholas Bostic, was out getting gas around midnight, as you do. And that's when he noticed that a two-story building was on fire. He pulled up to the house, intending to call 911. But as he pulled into his pocket, or rather, he went into his pocket looking for his phone, he realized, oh, I don't have my phone. So what he does is brilliant. He realizes that he has to take action. So he goes to the back of the house to check if there was a door open, and sure enough, it was. This must have been a really nice neighborhood or something, or people trust each other. I can't imagine ever leaving my door unlocked. It's just crazy. It's just a crazy concept. Well, then he selflessly runs in to see if anyone was inside, and he sustains first-degree burns on several areas of his body as he's able to save several children and their babysitter from the acrid smoke and fire. Now, people from all over the world, moved by his heroism, have chipped in nearly $500,000 to help fund his recovery. This guy is super based. Please pray for that grace to be as selfless as he was, should you ever find yourself in that sort of situation. It's really incredible. Well, that's going to do it this week for The Memory Hole. Thank you very much for tuning in and making it this far. Please make sure to like this video and subscribe to Catholic Drive Time. And let me know in the comments which story you found most interesting. Until next week, God willing, this was Rudy Carlos. God bless you and Mary keep you. See you next time.